Day after day, you never change. Ever the same, there is hope in your name. You are the fire that's burning bright. Ever you reign, so we're lifting you high. Everybody, everybody, come on somebody. One, two. After breath, we're so alive. Ever we're changed, cause you rescued our lives. The first and the last, no one in between. Ever the king of the song that we sing. Everybody, everybody, come on somebody. One, two, three, four. Everybody shout, make it loud. All of heaven sing. Hear the sound, let the praises ring. You're renowned. Every day we live, every day we live to praise you. Every day we live to praise you. Oh, the joy of the Lord is our strength. 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 One, two, three, four. Everybody shout, make it loud. All of heaven sing. Hear the sound. Let the praises ring.
Welcome to Family Worship Center. We're glad you're here. You joined us to worship our Heavenly Father and just see what He has in store for us. Amen. Greet someone, shake someone's hand, tell them you're happy to see them this morning.
sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free.
Upon the waters, wherever you would call.
kings are standing amazed. Here in your presence, we are undone. Here in your presence, heaven and earth become one. Here in your presence, all things are new. Here in your presence,
the kings and the
my favorite words that we sing was undone. The one thing about God is that we are undone when we come before Him, because He knows every single thing about us, and yet He still loves us. He knows that we have turned away from Him at one point. We have done our own thing, and yet He still loves us. He knows the good and the bad and the ugly about me. And yet He still yearns for my companionship. He still yearns for me to go to Him, because we are undone. We can't come to God and just say, God, I'm going to hide this away from You, because He knows it already. And yet He's still calling out to you, and He still has a purpose for each and every one of us in here. So when we throw away those excuses and become undone before the Heavenly Father, we realize that we're worth full. I don't know if that's a word. I'm always coming up with words, right? We're full of worth. He has a perfect plan for each of our lives here. Allow yourself to be undone. Allow yourself to realize that no matter where we've been, what we've done, what we've said, what we've seen, wherever we've let our mind wander, and what we understand about God, He still loves us, and He still has a perfect plan for our lives. Amen? There's nothing that can deter Him from what He wants for our lives. It's kind of hard being undone, isn't it? Lord, right now we call out to You. Lord, we bear our soul, we bear our heart, we bear who we are, Lord, that You would come into this place, come into our hearts. And Lord, that You would show us the worth that we are. Lord, that You would show us that had it just been one person, You would have died on the cross. You would have sent Your Son to die on the cross for our lives. Oh, Lord, we glorify Your name and we thank You. In Jesus' name we pray.
God's going to do something incredible in somebody's life. I do believe that before this day is over with. Holy Spirit is here to work in somebody, and Saul was talking about that word that he doesn't really like, undone. Man, I agree with that. But I believe there's some people here today that you feel like you're undone, that you have not received what God wants to do in your life. We're just going to take a pause today, and we're going to pray. And if you need special prayer, I believe God's going to answer your prayer today. Amen? As we were praying this morning in our pre-service prayer, I turned to Philippians chapter 4, and I read something that I thought was just amazing. And it says, rejoice in the Lord always. But the writer didn't stop there, because it's almost like a parent that he said it and you didn't get it. So he says, rejoice in the Lord always. Oh, by the way, if you didn't get it, what does he say? I will say again, rejoice. He's reiterating that there is power in our praise. There's power in praising God. There's power in giving that to God. But it goes on in verse 5 and it says this, be anxious for nothing. Don't let that enemy whisper lies into your ear and believe it. Don't let your mind get so screwed up that you can't think rationally. But it says, be anxious about nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, do what? Let your request be made known to God. The healer's in the house. The deliverer is in the house. The one that's going to set you free is here. Men, I want to talk to you for just a moment. Do I have any men in the room that have been through a situation and it was dark? And men, God saw you through and you knew it was the hand of God that did it. Is there any men in here? Can you raise your hand? And I need some men who you could be a testimony of that. I need you to come right here really quick. You don't have to say anything. You're just a walking testimony of God's incredible greatness. Hey now, is that not incredible when we got this many men that will come forward? God's a miracle worker? God a miracle worker? Is God a miracle worker? He's a miracle worker. God's a miracle worker. Is the miracle worker in the house? Is he ready to show up and do something in somebody's life? Reuben, come here. This is a testimony of what God can do in someone's life. Sometimes we go through stuff. And I believe sometimes it's because the enemy throws junk at us to sidetrack us. Sometimes it's because of stupid stuff that we do, and sometimes it's because of stupid stuff that other people do. But no matter what it is, sometimes we get stuck in situations. And I want you to know something. You're in a dark hour. I do know that. But God is about to do something. He's going to show himself faithful to you. I just believe this with everything that's in me. I was praying for you last night, and I believe God is going to show up in an incredible way. It may not be the miracle. This is what the Holy Spirit spoke to me. It may not be the miracle you're wanting or you're expecting, but it's God leading you. He has brought you to this place for a specific time. I brought men that know how to pray, okay? These guys are going to pray with you like men know how to pray. We're going to seek a miracle on your behalf. I want you to do something. I literally want you to stand on the word of God today while they're praying for you. If it's 1 foot, 2 foot, whatever you need to do, but I'm going to lay that right there. I want you to stand on the word of God, and we are going to trust God. I need some ladies to get with Whitney right now, some ladies that know how to pray. Hey, Whitney, there's a miracle in the making. There's a miracle in the making, okay? In the name of Jesus, we come against any weapon that has been formed against us that is going to try to tear us down. Father, we're going to pray right now that the anointing of the Holy Spirit will be strong upon Reuben's life. Father, I'm going to pray that any lie that the enemy has tried to tell him will go away in the name of Jesus. Father, I'm going to pray that he will put on a mindset that you are in charge, that he has given his life to you, that everything is going to work out according to God's plan. We're going to claim the miracle. We're going to walk in that miracle, and we're going to receive that miracle, and we're going to praise our way through the very midst of this storm. We're going to praise our way through, and we're going to trust God to do what he does best. When we don't see there is an answer, when we don't understand how we're going to get out of it, when we don't know what is taking place, God, we know that you see the beginning and you see the end. You've got the miracle, and all we've got to do is trust you. What you've got for each and every one of us. Father, touch Reuben right now. Father, I pray that you will fill his life right now. Father, I pray that right now that you will just engulf him with the power of the Holy Spirit to be strong, to be wise, to understand, and give him peace. Give him peace. praise. Give God a praise. Hey, before we stop, is there anybody just needs special prayer? You don't have to come forward. I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand right now. If you need special prayer, there's an entire family around you that just wants to lay a hand on your shoulder and pray with you. Before we go any further, just somebody pray with me. There's a hand right there. There's a hand back here. Is there any all right here? Hey, somebody touch somebody. Raise your hand up so that everybody can see that hand. Right over here. Let's pray. Father, we know that you've got all of these situations. Father, we know that you've got all of these problems under control. God, we know this. You are the miracle worker. You have proved it in the past, and we know this. You're going to prove it in the future. This raise of hand signifies a need that is real. And Father, we're going to pray that right now in the name of Jesus, that as we give this to you, that you deliver us, that you set us free, that bondage is gone in the name of Jesus, and we begin to walk in freedom that you have claimed for us to have from the very beginning. We receive a miracle in the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody receive it. I receive a miracle in the name of Jesus. Hey, put your hands together and praise him. Just praise him. Give him a moment of praise. Man, we're in this series, and it's been a good series, hasn't it? Robert Kirkendall told me, he said, I'm coming to church today with my hard hat on, my steel-toed boots on, and I'm going to get behind Billy Warner. Yeah, good place. That's what you call a big shield. But it has been an incredible series as we have dove into it, just really looking at what it means when you say, I've got your six. I've got your six comes from a military term, really, that it means I've got your back. It doesn't matter what the situation is. It doesn't matter what the circumstance is. It doesn't matter what the fight, where we go. You need to understand, when I'm around, I've got your six. I've got your back. And as a child of God, what I've been trying to get across to us as a child of God, it doesn't matter what we're going through. It doesn't matter what the circumstance is that we face. It doesn't matter truly how dark we think it might be. It doesn't matter what the naysayers are screaming in our ears. We've got to understand God's got our six. God's got our back. He has proven it over and over and over again. And as we go to the Word of God, we've just been reiterating the fact that God's got this thing under control. Amen? Just to reiterate, we started week one. In week one, we talked about our focus. See, the Word of God says that without a vision, well, I said without spiritual insight, without really being able to see what God is doing in our lives, without a vision, we die. Without a vision, people perish. We looked at Matt Emmons. He was an Olympic shooter, and he was shooting for the gold. All he had to do was hit the target anywhere to win the gold. He was that good. He took his aim. He took a deep breath, he squeezed the trigger, he hit the bullseye, only to find he hit the wrong target. It took him from gold medal to number 8, completely knocking him off the gold medal stand. Without a vision, people perish. See, it's not enough to hit the bullseye, we've got to hit the right target. Well, week two, we talked about heart. That was a tough one, wasn't it? We talked about heart. And we went to Galatians chapter 5, and we looked at the difference between the spirit nature and the human nature. We looked at really the attributes of what I call the attributes of God, the fruit of the Spirit, and then the counterfeit fruit of the Spirit, which the enemy throws at our life. And man, what an incredible walk through Galatians 5 we did with that. Week 3 last week, how many enjoyed last week? Man, last week was awesome. We ended with an incredible altar time. But last week, I titled it, How Big Is Your Butt? I love that one. Paul and Silas, they're sitting in their midnight hour. They are sitting in the deepest and darkest moment of their life. And the Word of God says, but at midnight, Paul and Silas begin to pray And Paul and Silas begin to sing. And in the middle of their praise and in the middle of their prayer, the supernatural absolutely broke loose in that prison. And every prisoner was set free through the supernatural shaking of the Holy Spirit. There is power in your prayer, and there is power in your praise. Well, today, I want to talk to you about you. About you. I want to title today, Don't Underestimate You. Don't underestimate you. It was September of 1779. It was in the middle of the North Sea, and John Paul Jones, fighting for the American colonies, was the commander of the warship, the Bonham Richard. The Bonham Richard was around 900 tons. It was a very slow-moving warship, but it was the most heavily armed vessel that he had ever commanded. The British warships spotted him in the middle of that sea, and they began to fire at him. And history tells that the majority of this battle was fought at night, in the nighttime hour. And this battle was fought by the moonlight. It was during the middle of that fight, in the middle of that night, the Bonham, Richard, grappled with a British warship, the Serapis. And these two vehicles, vessels, were lashed together. At that moment, the British captain looked down at John Paul Jones and he asked this question, do you surrender? And John Paul Jones made history in that moment when his answer was this, surrender? I have not yet begun to fight. He began to fight in what seemed like a sure defeat. He began to lead his men in a battle that looked like it could not be won. And 3 hours later, those British captains had surrendered their ships, their guns, and their men to John Paul Jones. Never underestimate the power of you. How was he able to do this? It was all because John Paul Jones refused to give up. He refused at the moment of defeat to give in. He refused to doubt what could be done. He refused to look at the opposition, and he would only look towards victory. And when all hope seemed abandoned, he said, surrender, I have not yet begun to fight. Again, I say, don't underestimate the power of you. See, John Paul Jones showed up that day with an agenda. What's your agenda? Because John Paul Jones showed up with an agenda to win. John Paul Jones, that day when he got out of bed, got dressed, and got on the warship, his agenda was to have victory at all cost. His agenda was not to just fight. His agenda was not to just survive, but his agenda was to fight and to conquer and to obtain victory. You know that fight is recorded in history as the beginning of our independence because one man said, surrender? No way. I haven't even begun to fight. So I put his resolve in one sentence, and I believe this was his resolve. I am the one. This is the place, and now is the time. I am the one. I'm not waiting for anybody else to do it. This is the place that God has called me to, and now is the time, because there's no better time like now to get started. Now, if the human spirit is capable of that much resolve, what would happen if we as God's people would allow the Holy Spirit to say something inside of us? What would happen if this church, as God's people, would allow God to speak inside of all of us with something so great and with something so powerful that during the middle of any midnight hour, during the middle of any battle, during the middle of anything that we find ourselves lashed to that has the tendency to want to take us down and to take us under, what would happen through the unction and the function of the Holy Spirit working in our life if we would have the resolve, if we would have the agenda to stand up and say, in the name of Jesus, I am the one. In the name of Jesus, this is the place. And in the name of Jesus, this is the time. What is the agenda of God's people? What's the agenda? Because whatever you expect, you will get. Whatever we don't fight for, I believe we will lose. Hey, I can handle this tug if God will just pull me through a knot hole. You know, I can handle it. So the prayer is this: Holy Spirit, move in me, move through me, and use me mightily. Don't underestimate the power of you, because you can make a difference. Well, as I say that, some of you may be sitting here today and you go, really? I can make a difference? Do you know how big of a screw up I am? And you say, I can make a difference? Do you not realize that everybody looks at me like I'm an alien with three heads when I walk into my classroom in school because I'm not like anybody else? And you think God could use me? Oh, really? I've got so many tattoos and piercings and I walk in place, all I get is stares. And you think God can use that? Do you know what I did last night? Do you know how obliterated I got? Do you know who I slept with? Do you know the situation I got into? Did you know I was a thief last night and I stole something? And you're coming in this place today and you're telling me God can use me? Don't underestimate the power of you. Do not do it. Because God created you with the ability to win. I don't think it's just an ability to succeed, to conquer, to have victory. And what the Holy Spirit, I believe, is trying to teach us is this: though you can accomplish a lot of stuff on your own, in me, you are unstoppable. Yeah. Unstoppable in the name of Jesus. So, are you special? Are you special? The psalmist wrote something that I thought was very incredible, talking about dark moments, talking about midnight hours. But the psalmist wrote something, and we quote the first part of this, 139:13. We quote this a lot, but we don't ever go up to verse 12 and really talk about verse 12. So instead of just reading verse 13 to you today, I'm going to read Psalm 139, verse 12 and 13. And it says this: even the darkness will not be dark to you. Grab a hold of that in your spirit for just a moment. The glory of God, the presence of God is so bright that darkness cannot exist in His presence. When God walks in, the dark disappears. When God walks into situations, the light and the glory of who He is illuminates everything. Even the darkness will not be dark to you. He can't even see dark for what dark is when He walks into it. The night will shine like what? We're in a midnight hour. In a lot of situations in our life, and it may seem gloom, and it may seem ugly, and it may seem like there is no hope, but when God is in the middle of it, it says the night will shine like the day. Come on, somebody grab a hold of that. The darkness is as light to you. And then He goes in and He talks about just how special you are to Him. And this is what He says: for you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Why? Because God's got a special plan He took time to make you specific so that when you go through the dark moments in Him, the darkness disappears. Amen. See, this is what you have to understand is this. The DNA that makes you makes up who you are is very unique. Are you ready for this? This is deep. Are you ready? There has never been a you before you, and there will never be a you after you. You are you. You are a one of a kind. There's no one else like you. You are an incredible piece of art. The Word of God literally calls you a masterpiece. And you were uniquely designed, if I could steal the words from Esther, for such a time as this. You weren't born in 1960 because God's plan was for you to be in the 20s. Wow. God's plan is for you now. You are one of a kind. A masterpiece. Special. Somebody needs to hear this. You're not a mistake. You are not a piece of trash to be thrown out. You are not junk. But you're special. I am the one. This is the place, and now is the time. Somebody repeat that with me. I am the one. This is the place, and now is the time. So just how special are you? God just didn't pop you out and put you here with no plan and no purpose. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. He created you specific. He created you with incredible detail. Check this out. You have eyes that have 100 million receptors in them so that you can enjoy the flight of an eagle and the fall of a snowflake. 1 million receptors in your eyes. You have ears that have 24,000 fibers that are vibrating so that you can hear the crash of an ocean, so that you can hear the clap of thunder and the gentle, small whisper. Isn't that incredible? Do you know your body has 7 miles of nerve fiber in it that is synchronizing and giving your body agility and movement? That's incredible, the detail that is in you. Did you know that you have a heart that will beat 36 million times this year? Now, I'm unusual because mine will beat over 40 million times this year because I'm married to the hottest woman in the world. But you have a heart that will beat 36 million times this year. That heart is going to pump over 600,000 gallons of blood through 60,000 miles of blood vessels, veins, and arteries that are in your body. Tell me you are a mistake. God took great detail in creating you. The average body will hold around 5 quarts of blood. And in that blood, there are 22 trillion cells. And with each one of those cells, there are millions of molecules. And on each molecule, there is an atom that is oscillating at 10 million times a second. And every second that ticks off the clock, 2 million cells die and 2 million cells reproduce themselves in your body. You are not a mistake. You are special. God designed you in an incredible way so that you can conquer, so that you can win, so that you can overcome, and that you can have victory in your life. You are not a mistake. You are not an accident. You are designed by the Creator Himself to carry out a plan, to carry out a mission. Again, I'll say, do not underestimate the power of you. The DNA that makes up the essence of who you are is unique, and it is amazing. Isn't it? Just absolutely amazing. But guess what? So is the DNA of the local church. The DNA of the body of Christ is unique, and the DNA of the body of Christ is amazing. See, as a child of God, I believe you cannot separate yourself one from the other because you are the church. This is a building. You are the church. So the DNA of this place, according to the creation that is in you, the miracle that is in you, the miracle that is in this house, the DNA when God brings all of this together is absolutely incredible. The church and the power of the Holy Spirit working in us, the local church should be and can be unstoppable. Amen. Within the body of this church, there are millions of eyes to see the needs of people around us all the time. Within the DNA, the structure of this church, there are millions of ears that are hearing the cries of the hurting and hearing the cries of the lost. In the DNA of this church, He has given us a heart that is pumping out the vision and pumping out the reason for Jesus Christ coming, living, dying, and being resurrected for the remission of our sins. That reason is spelled out in Luke chapter 19, verse 10. And it basically says this: this is the DNA of who we are as a church. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. We may have a lot of programs in the church. We may do things outside the church. We may go to Six Flags with the youth. We may take kids to camp. We may do all kinds of different things as adults. We may cook steaks out back. We may have trunk or treat. But never forget that all of the programs, everything that we have, is the DNA that is uniquely designed for one purpose and one purpose only. And it is the purpose that Jesus Christ laid out, that we should be in the business of seeking and saving that which was lost. It is our mission, and it is a mission that is empowered by the Holy Spirit. How in the world are we going to do this? God doesn't leave us out hanging out dry. He doesn't leave us hanging out to dry. That's what I was trying to say. Because anytime God puts a plan into place, He gives us a way to get to where He wants to take us. Every time. God is not a quitter. God does not give up on you. God didn't give up on you when you were in the middle of your worst sin. While I was still sinning, Christ died for me. That's how special you are. Uniquely designed to do an incredible work. Well, what are we supposed to do? The Holy Spirit leads us. The Holy Spirit guides us. The Holy Spirit directs us, and the Holy Spirit empowers us to do the plan that God's got for each and every one of us to do. I can prove this. It is in Luke 4:18, and it says this: the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. Who?
Me.
Who?
Me.
Say it again.
Me.
The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Why has God poured His Spirit out upon His people? This is the reason why. Because He has anointed me. Was anybody here when Tish preached Christmas about the shepherds? And they would have to anoint the sheep's head. Why? Because there was flies that would get into the sheep's ears, get into their nose, get into their eyes. But those flies would lay eggs inside the nostrils of the sheep. And it would hatch, and those little varmints would go up into the brain, literally drive the sheep crazy. They would ram their heads into brick walls, into trees, whatever, to try to stop the itching and the confusion. And they would ram their heads into things until they would kill themselves. And so the shepherds would anoint their head with oil. It was a protection from the evil one that would come into your head. Why does the evil one come? To kill, steal, and to destroy. So the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed, it is a covering of the Holy Spirit, he has anointed me to do what? To proclaim the good news to the poor. I am to give the message of Jesus Christ to those who are poor in their spirit and don't know him.
That's right.
I've been called to be an evangelist. I have been, not me, you have been called to be an evangelist. You have been called to be a testimony of maybe a testing that you're in the middle of. You have been called to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me, you, he has sent me to do what? Proclaim freedom to the prisoners. No weapon formed against me is going to prosper. Because I am the head and I am not the tail. I am the beginning and the end in Jesus Christ. That's who I am as a child of God. I am adopted into the family of God. I am in a new creation. I am a new person doing a new thing. I have a plan and I am uniquely designed by the Creator for such a time as this. To proclaim freedom to the prisoners and the recovery of sight to the blind, and to set the oppressed free. It's what God's doing in our lives. Each and every one of us. We talk about this DNA of who you are. I believe the DNA of our church is exactly the same. The DNA of our church is strong. The DNA of our church is right. The DNA of our church has a purpose. The DNA of our church has been breathed, I believe, by the Holy Spirit himself. So we can be who we are. I need to tell you something. We're not the church down the street. We're not the church around the corner. We're not your grandma's church. We're not your next door neighbor's church. We have a DNA that is ours and ours alone. It is what God has breathed into this pastor, what God has breathed into this church. It is the DNA of Family Worship Center, who we are, what we are going to be about, and how we are going to make a difference in our community. And that DNA starts off with this: doing church differently. Yes, I repeated this just a couple of weeks ago, but let me reiterate it. It's our DNA, doing church differently. What in the world does doing church differently mean? It means get off of your blessed assurance. Get out there and share the gospel with someone. Go next door, knock on a door, carry someone's groceries, do something, show the love of Christ, and who knows what God is going to do through an act of kindness through you. Every member, a minister, is doing church differently. It all comes from the Leviticus tribe that whenever Moses had the Ten Commandments, he came down and they were all screwing up doing all this weird stuff. And Moses said, whoever's on the Lord's side, get over here. And the Leviticus tribe got up and they went over, they sat down, and God said, I'm going to anoint these people as the bearers of the tabernacle. They will set up the tabernacle. They will take care of the tabernacle. So what God's plan was for the Leviticus tribe, he said, now each one of you are going to be priests. It was God's intention for all of us to be a priest. Not a priest with a white collar, but a priest that shares the gospel. And so when Jesus Christ came, he adopted us all into a new family. So we ask this question: who am I?
I'm a priest.
And what do I do? That's it. I am a priest and I set up a place for God and man to meet. It is what I do. It is I bring people to God. I introduce people to Jesus who can change their life. We saved a seat for you. What does that mean? I will never get too comfortable in my place of worship that I don't make a place for someone else. I will get up and I will give you my seat. I will stand against the wall. I will do what I never need to do because we have saved a seat for you, because we know if we can get you here, God will do something incredible in your life. We saved a seat for you. There's no perfect people allowed. The only perfect one I ever knew, they hung him on a cross. We don't care what you did last night. You're welcome here. This is all we ask. No perfect people allowed. Come as you are, but don't leave as you came. Don't leave as you came. Let God do something incredible in your life. And then it all boils down to the fifth one. It goes all the way back out to the beginning. The fifth one is this: found people, find people. I'm glad I was found. I'm glad God found me. And I want people to experience the very same thing that I have experienced in Jesus Christ. So if the DNA is set to doing church differently, how do we as a church accomplish this? Everyone has to take ownership. Everybody. You're not really a member of Family Worship Center. You are an owner in Family Worship Center. Our government, as great as it is, does not keep our doors open. Our state, the Lone Star State, I love Texas. I love Texas. I love that big star. But our state does not keep our doors open. Our community, our city, and our country doesn't keep our doors open. They don't keep our lights on, and they don't keep our ministries going. As an independent church of Jesus Christ, we only have two resources that we depend on: God and people. And God owns 1,000 cattle on the hill, but he uses people to do his work. God uses our hands, God uses our heart, God uses our mind, and God uses our money. It's all wrapped up in our time, our talent, and our treasure. So as an organization, we have to understand this. The church is a ministry. It is the DNA of who we are. But on the other side of that, the church is a business. And in the middle of a business, we have to be able to take care of the business to keep our doors open. We've got to make sure that the money is there so you're comfortable with heat, you're comfortable with cooling, with our air conditioning, that you're comfortable with all the necessities that you've got, that we can do ministry and that we can do it well. But if you know this about any business, businesses close their doors when the cash flow stops. Well, today I want to talk to you about tithing. I want to talk to you about giving. I want to talk to you about the generosity of your heart according to who we are, the DNA of who we are as Christ followers and as a church. Now, whenever you talk about tithing, people get upset. People don't like to talk about tithing. People don't like for a preacher to give up and tell you you have to give. They don't like for anybody to do that. So today I'm going to tell you, you don't have to give. Okay? I'm going to stand up here today and I'm going to be so bold to say this. Forget about your 10%. Just forget about it. Forget about the 10%. Throw it out the window, because we're going to talk about some things. We're just going to look at some things, and then I'm going to let you make a decision at the very end. Whether you're talking about Old Testament or New Testament, tithing is probably one of the biggest debated issues that we talk about. But the most frequent scripture that we use according to tithing, anybody know? Malachi chapter 3. I'm going to take you there, Malachi chapter 3, and it says this is what we base a lot of our scriptures on tithing. So we're going to go to Old Testament law, we're going to go to New Testament grace, and we're going to see what the Bible says about giving, okay? Malachi says this: bring the whole. What does that mean? What? Bring the whole tithe. How much is your tithe? Okay, let's look at that for just a moment. If I earn a buck, what belongs to me? And what belongs to God? I don't call him a greedy God. Because the government will take a lot more than that from you. You know what I mean? But for every dollar you earn, every dollar you make, God says this: a part of that is mine. Now, people don't like it when you talk about tithing because they say it's an Old Testament principle. Okay? Well, let's look at Old Testament principle with New Testament grace and see what God's calling us to do. But he's not a greedy God. It's not at all. And he says this: bring the whole tithe, that means a tenth according to the Old Testament, bring it into the storehouse, that is the local church, the body, that's who we are at the storehouse, that there may be food in the house. That is, the resources are there to take care of what we need to take care of. By the way, our electric bill just last month was over $700. That's just an electric bill. That's not everything else that we have at the church. So I'll just tell you that. And then God says the most incredible thing. He says, test me in this principle. Test me in this. Test me, says the Lord of God. And in that test, God says this. And see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven. In this testing, see if I will not pour out such a blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. About 10 years ago, can I come down on the floor? About 10 years ago, we were in the middle of ministry. Things were going good in our lives. And God began to stir in my spirit. He wanted me to do something different. Ministry was good, had a good paycheck, you know, had what I needed, taking care of business. We loved our ministry, but we could feel a wrestling. Now, some of you have heard some of this. You haven't heard all of this testimony, so just stick with me. But there was a wrestling inside of us of something different. Sometimes God begins to move, and you have no clue what he's doing. You know what I mean? Sometimes God will give you an urge. It's almost like a hunger pain, and you don't know where to go and eat. You just don't have a clue. And we kept feeling like God was doing something, God moving us. And I remember making this statement, but I feel like I'm in the mafia and I can't get out. There wasn't any job. People weren't knocking at my door offering me a job. There wasn't, you could get online and look and it's like there was nothing there. But there was still this feeling, this urgency to do something different and nothing. So for 2 years, my wife and I sat on this desire. For 2 years, it was like, there's something going on, but I don't know what. So we decided to help God out. Anybody ever prod God along? Kind of give God a little bit of a boost, a little bit of a help. But we begin to prod God a little bit and say, God, you're not moving quite fast enough. There's an urgency. So I began to collect everything I could collect to start my own church. We're going to pioneer our own church right here in town. And I began to collect things. Anything anybody was getting rid of, I don't care if it was a phone or a copy machine or whatever, I collected it and I put it in my garage. I was collecting microphone cables and microphone stands and whatever I could get my hands on that people were getting rid of. And I was telling God, okay, God, there's an urgency, so let me tell you what we're going to do. We're going to start a church, and we're going to do it like this, and this is what we're going to do, and this is what we're going to do, and this is what we're going to do. And every building in town that we looked at to put a church in, I am not lying to you when I say this, a church moved into it and opened one up there. We would sit in parking lots and pray over that building, God, this is what we're going to do for you. And we'd pray over that building, in the name of Jesus, you're going to give this thing to me, telling God what we're going to do. And then somebody would come take that building wide away from me, and I sit there going, what's up with that? I don't know about you. God never works the way I think he's going to work. Never. Never, 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 never. So building went out from under us, building went out from under us, building went out from under us. We look at buildings that, trying to start a church, that were $300,000, $400,000 rent, and we're like, how do you do anything like that? You know, you don't have $3,400 to have rent. And so we're looking at this thing going, but God, there's an urgency. There's something going on. What is it? And this church, the pastor of this church, a precious man that pastored this church, was going out of his retirement for the third time. For the third time. This church called me and they said this, God has told us to call you because you're going to be the next pastor of Family Worship Center and we want you to come for an interview. And I went, no. I've already told God what I'm doing. Is it okay for your pastor just to be transparent? I'm not going there. I know the kind of music I want. This church doesn't do it. I know the kind of preaching I want to do. This church doesn't do it. Nothing wrong with what they were doing here. That was their DNA, who they were. But I wasn't coming here. And Bruce and some other guys in this church, Bruce, thank you for sticking with an idiot like me. But they kept hounding me to come and kept hounding me to come and kept hounding me to come. And that thing's humming, so I'm going to go up here. And so they kept hounding me to come. And finally I came and I did an official interview with them. We sat right there in the fellowship hall and they got finished with the interview. I went, I sat down in my car and I went, no, I ain't going to do it. I even told Bruce, no, not going to go there. They called me for a second time. We came for a second official interview. And after the interview, I stood up and said, thank you, but no thanks. I've already told God what we're doing. I've already got a game plan. There is an urgency. I'm answering my call that direction. God's going to bless that, so no. I remember a guy named Jerry Hayes calling me up on the phone one night, and he said this before I came for the third interview. But he said this, we've got a stack of resumes on our desk for pastors to come here, and we've pushed all of them to the side because you're the man that's supposed to be here. And I said, no, I'm not the man that's supposed to be there. And he goes, yes, you are. And I said, no, I'm not. And he said, yes, you are. And I said, no, I'm not. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. I'm not coming. I'm not going to Family Worship Center. I'm going down the road. We've got a game plan. Leave me alone. Quit bothering. He literally called me every day for about 3 months. And I told him, no. And he says, let me share something with you. He said, this is a great church. It's got great people. But we are dying and we're going away. He said, you give this church 10 more years, it will not exist. We have got to change our music. We have got to change our style. We have got to invite young people in. We've got to have kids in. We've got to have youth in. We've got to have some life in the church. Because if it doesn't happen, we're going to close our doors. And we hate having this much time and energy and everything put into this for just to die and go away. And I was so compassionate, I told him, I said, I'm sorry, but no. They tricked me into a third interview. The third interview actually was me preaching and them voting on me, which I never said that I would do. But they told me they were voted on me after I preached. They kind of just stuck me to it. I came in and I preached and I told them, I said, I'll tell you what. If I get 85% of the vote, I will take the church. But I said, if I don't get 85% of the vote, I'm going to do what I'm going to tell God I'm doing. I'm going to go down the road. I came in and preached, and God's funny. I got 87% of the vote. Yeah. So I'm sitting there looking at this thing, and I'm going, I don't sing hymns, and my wife doesn't sing hymns. That's not who we are. This church did a lot of that, and they did a lot of older music. We're very contemporary. I was a youth pastor for 20 years. We worked with student ministries and college ministries, and everything we did really was on the cutting edge of worship. And I kept telling them, there's no way your church can handle the music that we do. Well, I was right about one thing. I was right about that. But we came into a very difficult situation. I want to say that to say this. God never says it's going to be easy. Never. God never says it's going to be easy. But God showed me this in my prayer time. This is something very incredible, and I want you to hang on to this. In my prayer time, I didn't hear it in an audible voice, but I heard it in my spirit every time I went through a dark moment. And let me tell you, there was a few dark moments in this church. But during those dark moments of this church, God would say this, I will prove myself faithful. I will prove myself faithful. I wasn't the most popular pastor in this church that this church has ever had. Because we brought in different music, and I know that you guys can contest to this. People didn't like the new music. We kind of kept sticking with the guns, and finally the pastor that was here, Max, Pastor Max, he said, hey, I want to talk to you after church in your office. And I went, dang it. I don't like talking to people after church in my office. It's always get chewed out when that happens. And Max took me in his office, and he goes, I want to tell you something. He said, if you can take some advice from an old man, because I need to tell you something. He says, I've done it right, I've done it wrong. And he goes, if you can take some advice, take this advice. He said, never back up, never cater to anyone, never give in to any desires of the people. You do what God has called you to do. You be faithful to the God, call of God on your life, and God will be faithful to your calling. He said, don't ever cater. So when Pastor Max walked out of my office that day and he had to leave the church and go somewhere else because, you know, you don't need two heads. It creates a monster in the church. Pastor Max left, and I remember standing there thinking, okay, God, this is what you have called me to do. I'm going to do what you have called me to do. And for the next 2 years, UGLY, you ain't got no alibi. It was tough. Ministry was hard. Ministry was tough. There were a lot of people that did not like me. I mean, we couldn't do it. It's like for 2 years, I couldn't do anything right in this pulpit. And God kept saying, I'm going to prove myself faithful. New pastor coming into a church, which the church had split just a month before we got here, so we only had half the congregation of what they did have. Finances were very low. It was a very tough time. Oh, and somebody came up and said, oh, by the way, there's something in the safe. We had about $100,000 debt that we were trying to pay, plus staff. And somebody said, oh, there's a letter in the safe that you might have some money out there somewhere, but you have to go get it. And I go, what do you mean by that? Oh, it's a whole deal. A church went under. They sold their facility. There's some money that's coming to you, but it was a stipulation, five-year thing. I think that's probably up. And I went, really? So I got it out, got to looking at it, and I read it. And we had like $80,000-something that was going to come to us. And I looked at it and I went, that's a bunch of malarkey. I'm going to tell you, your pastor was a man of faith. But anyway, I got to researching the thing out, got to looking at it, and sure enough, it had already come due. There was a church here in this town that was going to hand us $80,000. We were dead in the water. My mom was going to Dollar General buying toilet paper for the church. Bruce and Cherry would go to Sam's. They'd bring napkins for the church and paper towels. A guy named Don Parker would buy us light bulbs. I mean, we couldn't even go to the store and buy anything. We were just barely, we didn't go in the hole. We were just barely scraping by making ends meet. And God all the time said, but I'm going to prove myself faithful. Somebody would walk up to me after the service and say, I want to talk to you in the office. And I go, I don't want to talk to you in the office. And they'd go in there, and they'd hand me a $10,000 check and say, God told me to give you this, and then I'd never see them again. They never came back to the church. During that two-year period of time, with people coming, with people going, new pastor coming in, casting a new vision, people leaving because they didn't like me, we paid off about a $100,000 note with money that we did not have. And God said, I'm going to prove myself faithful. I want to say this, we're in our midnight hour right now because we've got more people in the church than we've ever had before. We're busting out in our children's church. We cannot get any more kids in our children's church. We have to get the building finished so we can move the kids out there because we're driving our adults crazy. Last Sunday, they had 14 babies in the nursery. That room is not big enough at all for what they're doing. We've got more people than what we've ever had in our entire life, but we have less money. This is our midnight hour, but I'm not giving up on God. But let me tell you what we're going to have to do, and you have to hear this from your pastor. A year and a half ago, we brought Pastor Chris on staff in faith that he could help us do what we need to do. The money is not there to keep Pastor Chris on staff. So I had to be the bearer of bad news and tell Pastor Chris, I'm going to have to lay you off. 20% of our church does 80% of the giving. I just tell you, 80% does nothing or very little because we went back and looked at the books. We have dissected every aspect of this. We can handle what we've got if everybody will just do what everybody needs to do. And that's not even the tenth. If everybody would just do what you need to do, we could handle it. Pastor Chris is now going to have to go find a job. He feels called here. He's not getting up and leaving us. He does not want to leave Amarillo. But Pastor Chris is going to go try to find a job, something that we can make ends meet in hopes that we can pull all this back together, bring him back on and do what we need to do. But today, it's our midnight hour. He don't want to leave. I don't want him to leave. My wife got mad at me this morning. She said, me and Chris had such a great meeting last night, and yada, yada, yada. Now he's got to leave. And I'm going, I know, it's not my fault. It's midnight. It's midnight. But it's not there. The 10th. Can y'all stick with me for just a little bit? Let me go to the New Testament. We're talking about the tithing that needs to come in. Is it a New Testament principle? Real quick, let's look at Matthew 23, verse 23. And it says this. Jesus is talking to the religious people in the church, and he's saying this. Woe to the teachers of the law and Pharisees. And he calls them, he says, you hypocrites. This is what he says about tithing. You are so concerned about tithing that you have let everything else in the ministry fall apart. So Jesus is talking to them about their tithing, and they were tithing. These Pharisees and these religious leaders, they were giving everything to God to a point that they were condemning everybody else. And he says, you give a tenth. They were biblically doing their responsibility. But you have neglected the more important matters of the law, which is justice, mercy, and faithfulness. And he goes on to tell them, you should have practiced the latter. You should have been more involved in ministry. You should have been more involved in people's life. You should have been more involved in helping people without neglecting the tithe. Jesus never backed up from the aspect that you should give, or maybe if you want to give. Jesus basically said it is your obligation to give. And Jesus talked about the tithe, the tenth. He says, you have to give. Who can help me up here real quick? Can somebody help me? Tab, you want to come help me? Whenever we give to God, God says, for every one of these, I'm going to have you stand right here, for every one of these, this is what I'm asking you to give. And so many of us balk at that because we make this our God. And we balk at that, but I can't give because I've got too big of a house payment. That was selfishness. We gave to us instead of to God. Well, now I've got two cars, three cars, four cars. God's saying, I don't care how many cars you got. Whatever you've got, a tenth of it truly belongs to me. So whenever God says, I give you an income, I give you a job, I give you a business, I give you resources, I do these things to bless you so you can bless the local body so that we can save that which was lost. And God says, so this right there, out of everything that you get, out of that dollar, that belongs to me. It belongs to me. So what God says he wants us to do with that is he wants us to give it. That's what we do. And God says, on your next paycheck, when you get paid again, there's a tenth that I require from you. And whenever you get that first fruit, it is a biblical principle that I'm laying out. When I give it to you, I want you to give it to the body of Christ for the work of the Lord. And every time you get paid through the year, you give it, and it's God's. You give it, and it's God's. You give it, and it's God's. It is a principle that God wants to set up because he says, give, and you shall receive. It says, how are we going to receive? We're going to receive that giving. It is going to be pressed down. It is going to be shaken together, and it is going to be running over in our life. But what so many people do is we take that tithe and we close it. And we hold on to the tenth that belongs to God. And God says, I want to bless you. I want to bless your church. I want to bless your favor. And whenever we clench the tithe and we don't give to God what gives to God, God is saying, but I've got a blessing and I want to give a blessing to you, but you can't hang on to the blessing because you are hanging too tight to the tithe. And if you can't give to me, I can't give to you because you are hanging on too tight. This is the problem. You don't know how many dimes I have brought today. You don't know what the blessing is that God has got for your life. The abundance of what God wants to do in your life is absolutely incredible. And what God is saying, as long as you hang on to the tithe, I cannot bless you. As long as you hang on to the tithe, I cannot give to you. As long as you hang on to the tithe, you will receive nothing more than what you are hanging on to. But when you open your hand to the blessings of God, then give, and I will give you more. And I will pour out, and I will give you more. And I will pour out, and I will give you more. It is the abundance. It is the blessing. It is the favor of God that He wants to pour an absolute blessing into each and every one of our lives, so that we can receive from God. The biblical principle is this. The tenth is not yours. The tenth is what God gives you. Are you ready for this? Nope, you may not have ever looked at tithing like this before. The tenth, I believe, is what God gives you to hold you accountable to what God has given us. And Malachi says, when you hold the tenth. Oh, but that's Old Testament teaching. Jesus came to not abolish the law, not to get away with it, but to do what with it? To fulfill it. What you've got to understand, the principle of the tithe goes all the way back to Genesis, before God ever put it into law in writing. And the tenth belongs to God. We're in our midnight hour. We're in a dark time. But this is what I know. If everybody in this church would do something, I wouldn't have to get rid of Chris right now. If everybody will do something, when that next person calls that doesn't have gas, when that next person calls and their heat is turned off, when that next person calls and they don't have food on their table, I don't have to sit on the phone and say, I'm sorry, but the storehouse is dry. Do we understand that God's design was never for the government to take care of the needy? The government had to pick up the need to take care of the needy, because the church has laid down and kind of let that thing slack. When times were desperate, the Salvation Army was developed by the church. When times were in their darkest, the YMCA was developed by the church. It was the church. It is the church that is the hope for the world. It is the church, through what Jesus Christ wants to do in us, that is the hope of salvation for all of those who are lost and seeking salvation. It is what God has called us to do. It is the DNA of who you are. God has designed from the very core of who you are to be a giver. Don't be stingy. Don't be selfish. Open your hand, and God says, test me in this. And when you do, I will give an abundance that is so great, Ronnie terminology, I will shock your pants off of you. I will shock you. I will open the floodgates of heaven, and in your personal life and in this church, I will pour in mercy. I will pour in grace. I will pour in salvation. There will be an abundance of miracles. There will be an abundance of favor. There will be an abundance of blessings in this house, not only in your life, but in the life of the church. And together, there will be so much incredible stuff taking place that we won't hardly be able to contain it. I've gone over, and I close with this. If you say you cannot afford to tithe, if you say that, that's between you and God. I'm not telling you you have to tithe. And I don't think not tithing will send you to hell. How you like that? You're not going to go to hell if you don't tithe. I might kick you, but no. I want you to get with God. And I want you to trust God. Maybe it's the first time you've ever done it. And say, God, I have never tithed 10%. By the way, just to let you know, if you are a tither, you say you're a tither, but you don't give the full tenth, you're not a tither, you're a giver. Okay? Just understand, you're not living by a biblical principle of tithing. You're living by a biblical principle of giving. There's a difference between tithing and giving. Giving is above and beyond. Tithing is a requirement. But I want you to get with God, and I want you to make a deal with God. I'm not a tither, and I'm not a regular tither, and I don't even know if I can do 10%. But God, I think I can trust you with my faith that I have right now, my resources, my finances. God, I think I can trust you with 1%, with 1%. And I'm gonna encourage you to do this. Give God 1% and be faithful with that 1%. And I'll guarantee this, I know the faithfulness of God. You give 1%, he'll stretch that, and you can say, oh, I can give 2 easy. I can give 3 easy. If you want to know some principles on tithing, I want you to go buy The Blessed Life by Robert Morris. It's a book called The Blessed Life by Robert Morris. Begin to read that on the principles of giving. It'll blow your mind. But trust God and say, God, I want to give. I want to give. I want to give. I don't know how to do it, but I'm going to trust you. Find something in your mind. Find something in your heart. Get along with God and tell God, I'm going to go from here, but God, from here, I'm going to build to here. And trust God. I believe in our midnight hour, God's going to do something incredible. I need to end with this. We're not going bankrupt. Okay? We're not going bankrupt. There's some people that's asked that question. Are we going under? Not yet. No, we're not. What we're going to do is we've got to be proactive to keep our head above water. We've got to be very smart with what we're doing because God has given us an incredible mission and we don't want to blow it. But if everybody will do what they need to do, we can do what we need to do and give God the glory for what he's doing. Amen? Hey, was that good? Is that okay? Why don't you stand with me? Father, we love you and we praise you. And Father, we give you all the praise and we give you all the glory because you alone are worthy of our praise. Father, we know that it may be a dark moment in our life, but we know the moment that you step in, that you are so bright, the glory that shines around you is so bright that it illuminates and light comes to our darkness and darkness goes away. Father, we're asking for a miracle in our finances. We're asking for a miracle in our church. Father, we're going to pray that you'll just do what you do best, and that is miracles. And we're going to receive it with an open hand so that as you give, we can give, and that we can be the most generous giving church ever. Father, we love you and we praise you. And Father, I pray that as we leave this place today, that you'll put a smile on our face, a skip in our step, and we're going to be careful always to give you all the praise and the glory. As everyone says,